Hello, welcome to my talk. Thanks a lot, Keith, for letting me use your laptop. I'm Arndt Bergmann. I work for Linaro, and this is one of my countless side projects that I've been working on for a number of years now. So how many of you are currently working on 32-bit machines running Linux? One, two, three. Okay, this is very different from the last time I gave this in Edinburgh at ELC, where three quarters of the room were actually working on 32-bit hardware. So I'll get a little bit about into the background before we get to the current status. The basic problem that we're facing, most of you will know this, is the time T type in Unix and Linux. If it's 32-bit wide, then it will overflow in January 2038. And over the years, lots of solutions have been proposed for this. The only solution that is actually going to work is to make this 64-bit for everybody. It is 64-bit on 64-bit architectures. On 32-bit architectures in Linux, it is not. And if we fix this, then we'll be good for the next 300 billion years, roughly. Why do we actually care about 32-bit kernels? There is, in fact, a huge number of 32-bit machines out there. I did the statistics again before this talk and noticed that the current merge window was the first time that in the ARM architecture we've merged more new 64-bit platforms than 32-bit platforms. Up to now, it has always been the number of new work being done was more on 32-bit than on 64-bit. And we have an enormous number of machines that are out there that are being used, machines that may be 10 or 15 years old, but that's still good because the hardware requirements haven't changed much, and they still work, and they will keep working for the next 10 years. So examples of some hardware that we do support in the Linux kernel that is 32-bit, that has no reason to be upgraded to 64-bit, but that may well have to have a life of more than 20 years. We have some toys. I play with Legos from the 70s with my little son. And when we buy new Legos now, people expect them to last for a long time. If you if you're doing heavy industry work, there's basically guaranteed to be 32-bit Linux running on some of them. This, again, is a picture of a platform we do support in 32-bit ARM. And of course, they are supposed to last for a long time. And popular cars also run 32-bit Linux. It's getting less these days, but we have a lot of cars on the road, and people are still being cars are still going to be put on the road that have Linux running somewhere on the 32-bit processor in them for a while. And then, of course, there are some people that have much longer lifetime requirements than those. So the way things generally work, if you're working on an embedded system, you already start out with an older kernel because you buy an SoC from an SoC company, put it in a board. That board gets sold to another company that builds a product around that board. Then you work on it for a couple of years to have your application working. By the time things get on the market, a board may already be 10 years old. Then it gets sold for 10 years, and then when people buy it, after that, it can still be expected to be used for 10 or more years. So a 4.19 kernel, which is the latest release today, will be in hardware that people buy off the shelf 10 years from now, and people expect it to be running for 10 years, and it won't, because 19 years from now, they will lose. Then there's another problem. You have 32-bit user space. If you have an Android phone, you have a lot of applications on it. Most of those applications will be written for the 32-bit ARM user space, if they're using any C code at all. And there are other reasons to use 32-bit software. It's usually smaller, so if you're very space constrained, you want to make the hardware cheaper by using less RAM. Or if you want to be compatible with older hardware. And then you have the same problem even if you have 64-bit hardware or 64-bit kernels using 32-bit user space, that all has the same problem. And then we have other areas that are equally broken. You have a network protocol, you have some file format somewhere, some application writer decided to store the seconds in a 32-bit value because that makes it portable between 32 and 64-bit applications. Well, you lose. And then there's even hardware interfaces that you have to deal with. A lot of SCSI adapters want to know the time for timestamping certain events that happen on the disk, and then you have network protocols. All of these have to be audited. We know a number of those that are broken, and there are many more that we just don't know about what they use. So even if you have a 64-bit hardware, you will have all of these problems. And the real-time clock has other issues too. Some real-time clocks go until 2070, some go until 2100, and so on. They all have different bugs too. So what's the work that we're doing in the kernel? This is the oldest commit that I could find where we started fixing this. John has been one of the people working on this initially with me and others. So this commit was from 2014, where we actually introduced a 64-bit time type in the kernel. The goal here was to just start fixing the kernel from the timekeeping interfaces and work our way out into device drivers and then user space. At the same time, I started working my own way down from the system call interfaces into the kernel. And I recruited a number of people to help me out with device drivers. So we've had many, many patches just fixing device drivers to not use 32-bit time types anymore, but use something else that is guaranteed to work. And there's like a lot of different ways it can be broken in a different number of different solutions that we had to apply for all of those. The earliest work that I did on this was for the file system code, and I started that even earlier. And it's finally got merged earlier this year after 6 years of working on it. We've gone through probably a dozen revisions on it, starting from scratch. And then the system calls is the most awaited part of it, because that has to be done before we can actually start doing the user space. It's a list of different approaches that we've taken to fix individual drivers and user space interfaces. Keith already mentioned using clock monotonic in the GPU stack, which is one thing that we did. And also a lot of subsystems have I/O control interfaces. There's audio timestamps, there's input timestamp, video timestamps, video for Linux timestamps, socket timestamps. They all used TimeT, and we've had to find a fix for each of them, and basically each one of them had a different fix. And in a lot of cases, we also tried to not just fix the immediate problem of the overflow, but improve the code at the same time to either work faster or more reliable. When you're working with clock real time, which is the time that started in 1970, then that is also a problem if you call set time of day, or if you run into a leap second, and just using clock monotonic fixes both the 2038 overflow, because now we start at boot time and we have 136 years before that overflows. And it also solves all the other problems with the clock going backwards, which we don't want if you're trying to serialize events. Now, user space interfaces. So this one's really interesting because we cannot do that in the C library. So all the system calls, we just have to create new system calls in the kernel, and then the glibc can use the old or the new ones and export the old or the new interface to user space independent of those. For IO control commands, what you typically have is you have a command code which comes down to a 32-bit integer number, and it's defined as a derivative of a structure or an integer type. And in some cases, we use a time t or time val or time spec. And that means when we change this type in user space, glibc extends this from being two 32-bit values into two 64-bit values, then this command number changes, and the kernel can just implement both of them. So in this case of the PPP driver, we replace the implementation for the IO control, the PPP IOCG idle, with two implementations, one for the old structure and one for the new structure. And then this device driver can work on both versions. And we tried to do this in a lot of device drivers. It often worked, but in other cases, it did not work. So, I had a bug. Yes. No, wait, this one is.
There's a break that wasn't removed, right?
Yeah, so this is cut off. That's the. Right, yes, I see it now. Sorry. Yep. Good catch. Have to see if that actually made it into the kernel. So some IO controls that go back to the 80s are not defined in terms of these macros, but they are just a number, a 16-bit number. So the kernel has no way of knowing whether your user space is running a 32-bit time t or 64-bit time t, because we're not creating a new ELF ABI. We just have new system calls. So what we do here is we recreate this method at compile time. When we compile an application, we make it depend on the size of this structure. If it's 8-byte, we get the old value. If it's more, if it's anything other than 8-byte, we get the new value, which is then defined the way we normally define time val. And that means that whatever the C library uses, it will come to a unique command code, and then we can handle that in the kernel. And we hopefully only have to deal with two versions of time val, although I'll get back to that in a bit. And there's an even worse problem in some places where we don't have a command code. So for input events, you don't call an ioctl that tells you when the last input event happened. Instead, you read from a file descriptor and expect the kernel to come back with a data structure that contains a time structure again. So what we had to do here is to make it stop use time val at all, because time val is now defined by the C library to be one of two different things. But the ABI from the kernel can only be one specific thing. So actually, counterintuitively, we have to make it use a 32-bit result. And all applications that use these numbers have to be audited to make sure that they're doing fine. There are different ways how the application can do it. In the input time events, we can, again, tell the kernel whether we want monotonic or real-time timestamps. So the best fix is to always use monotonic timestamps, and then these 32-bit will be enough. If that is for some reason not an option, you can still use the 32-bit seconds as long as they are unsigned and you don't expect the application to work beyond the year 2106, where the unsigned seconds overflow. But really, applications should use the input event in with monotonic time, and I assume that at some point we will just remove the support for the currently default real-time seconds, as we've done in other subsystems already. And then there's yet another one that uses another interface. In the audio drive, we actually have a memory-mapped structure that can be used to export timestamps about audio events. And again, we have to redefine this data structure to have a type that does not depend on the glibc that you're being compiled with, because the memory map structure inside of the kernel may be shared by a number of processes that don't even have the same layout. And then the question is whether this should be using 32 or 64-bit times. And the current thinking on this is that we'll go to 64-bit times, but the patches are not yet merged. VFS was probably the hardest part. I've already mentioned that we've been working on this for 6 years. Deepa started as an outreachy intern working for me on this, and she picked it because it was one of the harder problems. She didn't think that it would take her 3 years, I think, to do it, but for a 3 months internship, that was quite a long time. But she actually followed up on this, and she's doing much of the harder bits now that I didn't even get around to do and couldn't do. So we're working together on a number of these issues now. Then StatX was an interesting one. Originally, I had planned to create a version 4 of the STAT interface. So STAT is a family of system calls. We have, I think, up to 12 different versions of STAT on some architectures, and I was going to introduce a couple more. Fortunately, Dave Howells came along and introduced STATX, which is a fairly complex, extensible system call, but it replaces all the others. So on new architectures, that's the only thing we need. U-times, I think we have the patches. I didn't get them into 420, if I remember right. But these are done. There are a couple of file systems that are not yet converted over to use the new VFS interfaces. Most of the file systems, the code actually works the same on 32 and 64-bit at this point. But some other file systems, like XFS and ext3, they still use 32-bit timestamps in the file system themselves, on disk format. And that requires much more complex changes than just changing the way we pass the data around. And ext3 is an example, will never be fixed. The fix is to use ext4, which has a new layout for the inodes. And if you're using ext4, it will just do that by itself. ext3 is the same code base already, so you just need to, if you have an existing file system, you need to make sure that it uses the extended inode format. And for XFS, we will use a simpler extension that will remain backwards compatible. For the system calls, we are mostly done. We have identified many years ago a list of, I think, around 50 system calls that passed a 32-bit time value of some sort. In theory, we could have replaced each one of those with a new version that just differs in the way we pass the times. Fortunately, most of those system calls, like STAT, already had a replacement, so we're only going to introduce around 20 system calls, and we're getting very close to doing that. So this 80% completion in 4.20, that refers to the implementation of the system calls. So none of those system calls actually have a number assigned yet. So you can't call them yet. But for the most part, it's just a matter of picking a number for each architecture and hooking it up so that if you call a system call with that number, it gets to the 64-bit function. And there's a couple of system calls that still, where we still need to make a decision about what the data structures are going to be that we pass in a future kernel. And if you want to talk about this with me, that would be very welcome. I've already asked a couple of people that usually have opinions about this, and none of them care, which is not a very helpful answer, but that at least means I can suggest a patch and see if anybody objects. So how do we do this? The important observation here was that for each system call that we have, we already have two implementations, because on a 64-bit kernel, on almost all the architectures, we are able to run 32-bit processes that also have a 32-bit time T. So we can just reuse the code that we implemented in the compat system call layer and make sure that on 32-bit architectures, we can now use the same two implementations for each of those system calls. The example that I pick is here Futex. That's one of the 20 that we're going to add. We started out originally with 32-bit architectures implementing each of those system calls. And as soon as we got 64-bit system calls, at least the decision was made to use 64-bit time T. That's very fortunate, but it means that we now have two slightly different versions of that system call. And the 64-bit architectures now have to implement a separate entry point that looks the same way as the 32-bit entry point, so we can run those applications. What we're doing now is we make sure that we can compile those system calls on 32-bit architectures. And the important step will be when we change over an architecture. One architecture at a time will get the new system call entry points. And then we can change the old implementation to have the same arguments as the 64-bit version, and then we have the compat one that we can rename to no longer be compat sys futex or something else, instead have a name, a sys futex time 32, which is then used on both 32 and 64-bit. This is the patch that we do. So instead of guarding this implementation with config compat, we introduce a new config compat 32-bit time, which will be selectable on 32-bit architectures. One other change, instead of passing a time spec, we need to pass a new structure, and I decided to call it kernel time spec. And that also helps for the kernel header files to no longer conflict with the glibc header files, because glibc now has, depending on how you compile an application, two different definitions of time spec. And we traditionally had one definition in the kernel headers and one definition in the libc headers. And you can include both of them because the definitions are the same. Now they're not the same anymore. So we really have to remove the time spec definition from the kernel and use only the libc definition in user space, and then come up with a new name. The interesting part here, again, is the transition. So what do we do at the moment where we don't have the system call entry points yet? All the architectures we have in the kernel, 32-bit architectures, still use a time spec definition in the kernel that has 32-bit times. And we have now changed the system calls to use a kernel time spec. So for the moment, we just redefine kernel time spec to be the same as time spec. And once an architecture gets changed, we remove this redefine and just use the 64-bit definition. Here's a list of the system calls that we're no longer using. So any new architectures will not have any of these. All these system calls have a replacement already, and in most cases, we have to replace that replacement again with a 64-bit version. These are the ones that we've already eliminated by replacing the new system call with a 64-bit version. So there's a couple that are already done, and there's a couple more that we have patches for that are not merged yet, but that will be merged in the next merge window. And the same thing goes for the system calls that we do need to replace. So each of them will have to remain usable by applications. Most of these have already got a replacement in the kernel. A couple more have patches ready that we need to get merged in the next merge window. And then there's a couple where we need to decide on an ABI and then implement it correctly in the kernel and in user space. This is one example where we have to make a decision. There are two system calls using the structure as get r usage and wait for, and also the Linux internal variant of wait ID, which is different from the libc version. What you notice here is we already have a kernel long T that is architecture specific. We have the time val that is different possibly in user space and kernel. It's also notable that both of these time val numbers are relative times. They refer to the amount of elapsed time inside of a process. So that means it is very unlikely to ever exceed 68 years. You could, in theory, exceed 68 years if you have a lot of cores and a long-running process. So if you have a supercomputer with a single system image running on 4,000 CPUs and run that for many months, then you certainly can have a process that exceeds this. But most of those supercomputers use 64-bit at least. So the first fix that we do is to change the structure again to not use timeval, because that breaks when you use a new libc. So using kernel old timeval will get you out of that namespace. We have an interface that is unchanged at the binary level. We just have something else at the source level. So if you include the kernel header to get R usage, you compile your application, it will probably work. If it breaks, it will actually break at compile time. And that only happens if you make the assumption that this is the same as a time val. And then you get at least a warning saying there's a type mismatch. The alternative to this is to have a new structure, kernel R usage. So this would be the approach that we absolutely have to do to keep it compile. This is what we might want to do in addition. Replace the time val with a 64-bit time val or a 64-bit time spec. I picked the time spec in this example because we really want to eliminate all uses of time val. Time val is almost the same as time spec, except it uses microseconds, and TimeSpec uses nanoseconds. So every time we have an interface using microseconds, we need to divide by 1,000 in the kernel, because the kernel, all the timekeeping inside of the kernel uses nanoseconds. And that division can be expensive. Then there's the question of how the TimeSpec should be defined in user space. This is an approximation of what the libc definition of time spec would look like. So this is an internal type inside of time spec, inside of glibc, which means it has underscores. It uses 64-bit, and time spec may be defined to time spec 64. We have the 64-bit seconds, and then C99 and POSIX both require the nanosecond portion to have the type long. And this is very unfortunate because it is different from what you use on 64-bit architectures. I already explained that all the system calls should have two versions. There's the version for old 32-bit processes and the version for any existing 64-bit process and the new 32-bit process. If we had a 32-bit nanoseconds value, that would mean the structure is no longer compatible and we'd have to have three entry points for each system call. And we don't want that. What we do instead is to make sure that the 32-bit nanoseconds are in the same bits as the 64-bit nanoseconds are on a 64-bit kernel. And then we have padding either at the end or at the beginning. But on a big endian architecture, the padding would be between the seconds and the nanoseconds. And that, again, causes problems if you have a static initialization of a time spec structure saying time spec x equals opening brackets 10 comma 10. Because that would initialize the second field instead of the third field. So we use an anonymous bit field, which is really, really ugly, but that's the best we can come up with. So TimeVal is actually worse, as I found out not too long ago. There's one architecture. There's actually two architectures that use 32-bit microseconds on a 64-bit architecture. This was originally done, I think, for compatibility with an old version of SunOS, and it was fixed in Solaris, but we are still compatible with SunOS on Spark 64. And the same code got copied into PA-RISC, where we just replaced it because there has never been a working user space on PA-RISC that used this. If you try to build a 64-bit PA-RISC glibc, you get a 64-bit microseconds, and then you just leak random kernel stack data into the 32-bit where you expect the times to be. So yes, this causes a lot of problem. In a number of patches, I have to revisit some things where I inadvertently replaced the kernel information leak with incorrect data by using a 64-bit microseconds on all architectures instead of using the time bell. So what are we doing now? Once the system calls are done and the I/O control interfaces are done, we need to get the libc implementations, all of them. Glibc is the most widely known one, and Albert Aribeau has been working on this for a couple of years already. He has a prototype working that actually works with existing kernels. There's a long design document about all the trade-offs and how things are going to be done inside of glibc. The interesting part about glibc here is that they decided that an application should be able to choose at compilation time whether it wants the old or the new time t. And of course, also all applications will have to keep working. So the new glibc can only add new interfaces to get new applications to work, but all existing applications will keep working, and you can still build new applications against new libc versions that work on old libc by not passing this macro. It's completely different from Muzzle. So Muzzle does not have any compile time choices for picking an ABI. And they also don't have any way to change an existing ABI. So the only thing that they can do is really to have a new version of Muzzle. So I expect there will be a Muzzle 2.0 at some time that will then have the 64-bit time t and also change a number of other things that they have been meaning to change for a while. I've done an experimental port where at the time of compiling Muzzle, I pick 32 or 64-bit time t, and I've tested that with an experimental set of kernel changes to make sure that my kernel patches are fine and I can pass an LTP. Once we have the libc, then it's about all the distros. So the trend in modern distros, at least on the desktop, is to just drop 32-bit mode entirely, and that helps. So most of the distros, the 64-bit distros, they will only have to fix the bugs where we find them. So if there's a file format or device driver that relies on passing 32-bit times even on a 64-bit machine, then we have to fix that. But that's business as usual. We fix a lot of bugs. But the 32-bit distros, it's easy for the ones that just build everything from source. They have to upgrade the kernel, upgrade the C library, turn this flag on, and then rebuild it all, and we'll be all good. Android is in the worst situation because changing their C library will just mean that they become completely incompatible with all 32-bit applications. So anything that you have running on your phone will have to be recompiled, unless it's already using, unless it's not using any C code or it's not using 32-bit code. But most of the popular applications just use the existing ABIs for 32-bit. And then for the few desktop distros, we need a migration plan. I try to find which desktop distros are still available for 32-bit Linux. These are the ones I could find, and I try to narrow it down a little bit by finding the ones that are likely to still have users of some sort, either running old distros or being still supported in 2038. It mostly comes down to 32-bit ARM, but also there's x86 on Debian, which might hang around for a long time. And for each of these, the question is, how do we approach it? We can either rebuild everything at once, which is a typical thing that Fedora does. They just have a global rebuild every other release, and then once you rebuild everything, it might introduce bugs if you try to combine it with old applications, but it will just work. While on Debian, it's much harder to do this, so there will probably have to be a longer migration over several years. This is the overall status that I made up. So core timer handling is where we started, and that's mostly done. We just have to get rid of a couple of interfaces once the last user is gone, and we have patches for all of the last users. And this is still work that one of my colleagues is doing on the system call tables that we're in the process of reworking to make it easy to see what's actually in a system call table and change them all at once. And then the C library and distros that will have to come after all of this is done. And that's it from me. Any questions?
Hello. So there is a wait ADCs call, which is similar to wait for. Not many people know that it has an argument that returns structure usage. So it would need a similar treatment as wait for. Wait ID.
Wait ID, yes. So wait, as I tried to mention that. So wait ID in the C library does not have our usage argument. In Linux it does.
So yeah, but syscall has. So.
So the what we do in Linux actually is to only change wait ID. There will not be a wait for system call, but then you can implement both the C library wait for and C library wait ID based on the new system call, if we introduce one. We could also just decide to not introduce a new wait ID, and then the C library will have to convert the binary structure from the kernel's format using 32-bit times into the user space format with 64-bit times.
So there are more reasons to introduce a new syscall. I'll be talking about it tomorrow for extending wait for. So maybe it will be a new syscall that would also count these problems and the problems with like missing.
So the good thing is that we already have the compatibility code for wait ID in glibc, And we can always add this later and make it nicer.
Yep.
Thanks.
So, Android. Not only do we have 32-bit applications, we also have older kernels and also many of them. Based on what you have, say, a system call being changed and updated to a 64-bit time structure, what does the C library have in order to know whether that's going to work on underlying kernel? Because with Android, the problem also is Android versions can also get updated over a period of time. Mm-hmm. So in the distro case, for example, the distro gets updated while kernel stays the same. How does the C library handle that in that case?
It cannot. So the C library can handle compatibility for system calls. So it can emulate the 64-bit interfaces on a 32-bit kernel. I don't actually want that because it gives it means we lose one possible tool, which is to disable the 32-bit system calls in the kernel to make sure that none of the interfaces are used by anybody.
But the problem is, how do we know if the underlying kernel has 64-bit system calls?
Unless
you recompile the whole thing, because we can't know that without recompiling.
Right. So actually, that's a more serious problem that you have.
Exactly.
If you have an older kernel, even if the C library can deal with all the system calls, you will not be able to deal with the I/O controls.
Right.
So as soon as you use timestamps on sockets, input, audio, video, DRM, any of those, you still lose because glibc has no way to intercept those.
Yes, and it, well, I'm just going to pile on because it gets also worse because in some cases you will have 64-bit timestamp, in some cases you won't. So it's going to have to work with both.
Right.
Unfortunately for us, there is no way to differentiate that right now. So I guess there's more discussion needed here.
So what is certain is that older kernels will not be fixable to run beyond 2038. What we have to discuss is how to fix older kernels retroactively to be able to run those applications that are fixed.
Yeah. Hi, question. Two versions ago of glibc, there was a new technology that allows to, on runtime, select which architecture you are. For example, for Intel specific x86. And based on that, you call the specific library that you want. Could that be a similar approach that could solve this problem at this point for what we're seeing here?
I think that's completely orthogonal, because what we need here is just the regular symbol versioning that we've been using in glibc for a long time. So you decide whether you want to use the 32 or 64-bit timestamps, and that means you get one entry point or the other into the C library.
That is actually what you did, the implementation that time, but for libraries. Maybe it could be something similar that could be applied here.
Okay, maybe I'm not on.
The runtime selection that now glibc said, for example, at boot time, I'm in a Haswell or Westmer, a specific Intel platform, and during runtime, it goes into search for a specific library in a specific path, use a lib64, whatever, .so. Maybe something similar could be applied over here to actually select the system calls that we're looking for.
Oh, so you would just duplicate every library again. So we have Haswell time T 64 on 32-bit. And yes, I don't actually think that glibc will have a lot of users that need both at the same time. I think they have their principles, and they're just doing it the same way for every new feature to meet users' expectations. But I don't think in practice that you will have that situation a lot.
Aaron, have you any idea if any other operating systems have faced this problem yet or solved it, or is the industry in general even caring about this yet? Like, or is there any 32-bit operating systems that matter out there at this point?
Sorry, I didn't get the start.
Is there any other like 32-bit operating systems out in the world that actually are facing this problem already? Have you heard of any industry like in Apple?
So facing the problem already. I've just heard about the case where HTTPS signatures have an expiration date of 20 years in the future, like the certificates. And if you want to visit a website that has such a certificate on a 32-bit machine, then it's already expired in 1902. So you can't visit those websites anymore. And we will get more of those, of course.
Last question.
Okay, when do you finally wire up the syscalls? Do you plan to do by architecture base, or do you plan to do for all architecture at one time?
The plan is to do them all at once. I'm not sure if we can do it. It will be either one kernel release or two kernel releases to do them all. So we've done a lot of preparation work to make it easier to modify system call tables. And that's currently being merged into the kernel. Once that is done, it should be fairly easy to just add the same system calls on all architectures at the same time.
Well, thanks, speaker.